Now, normally on this channel, I talk about web dev technologies, tutorial based on front-end, back-end, AWS, and various other stuff. But today, I want to go in a completely different direction and just talk about something that matters to you, me, and everyone around us. Now, what could be better than talking about religion itself? Now, I know religion is kind of really hot topic because everyone has this really like different opinion on it, and people are really easily triggered by the topic of religion. So I would really like to issue first disclaimer that I'm not here to just spread the hate. In fact, I respect all the people from various ethnicity, background, culture, religion, etc. My intention isn't to say that, hey, Hindu is good or Muslim is bad or Muslim is great or Hindu is bad. No, I'm just trying to just present here that why people fight over religion despite of science has progressed enormously. For that, we need to really understand the basic human nature and how religion kind of really perfectly fits into that puzzle. And this is something which is really close to my heart. And this is something which I have been really studying from last 4 or 5 months. And this video is a kind of really condensed video format over it. So let's begin.
The militants took control of the district on that day and a suicide.
To Afghanistan now, where the Taliban is seizing control of more and more territory.
Another strike on a three-story building in the Shati refugee camp has killed 10 members.
Maurice Gluck was 3 when his parents were deported from Belgium to Auschwitz, a move that tore the family apart. They were taken to the largest death factory in Nazi Germany, a concentration camp where more than 1 million Jews were murdered.
At the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India will awake to life and freedom.
Religion was supposed to bring peace to the world, bring humanity closer to one another. So what happened? Where did it go wrong? Now, to be clear, if you really see all of the war that has been fought in the entire history of humanity, you will really see that only 7-8% of them account on the basis of religious frontier. Most of them are just for land, water, territorial acquisition, power, status, etc. But we are not going to count over that. Now you might think about, hey, if all of the war has been fought based on land acquisition and not on the religious basis, then why are we discussing religion? Now, people really fight for various different reasons, and religion is kind of really like a pushing, motivating factor for that. How? We're just going to discuss over that. Now, according to the Pareto law, you can really confidently say that all of the 80% of the violence is caused by 20% of extremist people. Talk about American civil protest, whether you talk about any rape cases in India, or you talk about George Floyd protest, or you talk anything. Everything can be really just derived into the Pareto law of 80-20 principle itself. And this is a quest to really understand why humans actually do some such kind of irrational thing. Everything really begins with the inception and the place where we are born within our family itself. Now, we have no control where we are born within our family. Now, a childhood is also really critical to just shape his intellect and biases. Programming for the first 15 years will really determine how that person is going to live his entire rest of his life. And what kind of values and what kind of virtues is he or she gonna possess? What kind of value is he or she gonna really provide to the society? What kind of hatred he or she will really have? So there are a lot more parameters over here. Now, it is highly unlikely that most of us has perceived the information that we see around us in really exactly the same way. Now, let's say your background is really different from my background. So naturally, my perspective for the world is really different from what you have seen, because your tradition, your custom, your culture is really different from what my culture or my background really is. Now, to really understand why this can be a little bit problematic over here, Yuval Noah Harari really provided brilliant insight in his book Sapien. Now, life as a caveman was really simple. All you need to do as a man was to go hunt an animal, provide food and just security to your family itself. Rest all of the work, let's say nurturing babies, cooking food, picking fruits, and all of to do some lightweight stuff was really done by female itself. And all of this thing really continued for thousands of years itself until we really hit upon agriculture. Now, everyone really knows that agriculture is not a really easy thing. Either you can get a completely jackpot or you can get completely just crops really get can vanish. Now, as compared to hunting the animal, which is just readily available, all you need to do is just to go out, kill an animal and just hunt and roast and just eat it. As compared to that, agriculture is uncertain. You need to wait for months and months and they still not guarantee that you will just reap the harvest what you have just sown over in your field itself. And strangely, our ancestor adapted to this kind of new behavior itself. Now it was too late to go back to our initial old days itself. The beginning of the agricultural era marked the foundation of the modern world. Humans started to create systems like military, administration, etc. to be more efficient. Although with the downfall of living in hierarchical model, humans now have the free time to think about abstract ideas, which doesn't need to be in real life. As a cave mind, our mind was always busy with the thought of, hey, am I going to be eaten by a wild animal? Is my family alive? After the agriculture era, this wasn't the case anymore. And as you know, that empty minds is a devil workshop. By this, you can now very well guess at where we are going with this. Now, as the time progressed, human civilization really became more complex in nature. This gave rise to many oppression by kings, rulers, to its native citizens. Now take for example Mahabharata. Now according to common notion that it is really assumed that Mahabharata was fought between Kauravas and Pandavas, which indeed is true. But according to the logic of Krishna, the Mahabharata was actually fought to give justice to all the citizens of Aryavart or ancient India, because the kings, the rulers and all of the peasant were really extorting to its native citizen itself. Seems really weird to take such massive effort, but coming back to a point itself, when majority of us are in deep suffering and fight for basic rights, we need a psychological aid, aka hope and a guide that could lead us away from all of miseries. Now suddenly from all of the globe, various religion figures started to pop out. Be it Christianity, be it Islam, be it Judaism, Buddhism, Jain, Sikh, etc. The problem is not with the religion. The problem is how people really treat with the religion. Now let's take an example that science has proved that the earth is round. But still there are some people who believe that the earth is completely flat. I hope that you are not one of those. But let's say science has proved that 5G is kind of really like a boon and really beneficial to the mankind itself. And it is completely safe as per the scientific journals and all of that. There has not been really much more trial. But still, people really believe that 5G is kind of dangerous. And this is a scientific thing. Religion was completely based on belief itself. And here's where the real shit show starts. Now, I would really like to ask you one question, that what would you really provide to the people so that they could really convert into your own new religion itself? Suppose I really create one religion called Martianism, or let's say if I really create a religion, let's say my headphone religion itself. So how would we really entice people to really leave their religion and convert into my new headphone religion itself? What would be the aspect? Well, for this, we need to refer the Law 32 from the 48 Laws of Power, which states the following, and I quote, Law 32, play to the people's fantasies. The truth is often avoided because it is ugly and unpleasant. Never appeal to the truth and the reality unless you are prepared for anger that comes from disenchantment. Life is so harsh and distressing that people who can manufacture romance or conjure up fantasies are like oasis in desert. Everyone flocks to them. There is a great power into tapping into fantasies of masses. Don't you think religion really acts in a really similar way, which provides an escapism to all of the miseries? Now, how do you even know that you are Hindu, you are Muslim, you are Sikh, you are Jain, you are anything in that way? Probably, your just parents would have told you that, hey, we belong to this group. Now, did your parents really give you the choice that, hey son or hey daughter, this is all of the religion. Choose whatever you really like to want. And let's say if you really want to choose Islam, if you can go to Islam, if you really want to go to Hindu, you can really go to Hindu, or you can go to Jain, or you can go to Buddhist. It doesn't really exist. Now let's imagine that you had no parents. So in that case, what would be your religion? And these are some of the uncomfortable questions that no one really asks, because no one really wants to get their belief really challenged. Now all of this thing really, like, in the religion has been really passed to the generation itself. we have been believed that we are Hindu or we are Muslim or we are Christian just because our parents were really convinced that they were also really a part of religion, just because their own parents have told them that hey son, or like let's say to the hey, that we belong to this group. We never questioned that, why can't we just leave this thing, or why can't we be more agile or fluid with this concept. This thing really doesn't really exist, and I hope that this should really be exist over here. Religion by nature was evolved in belief system, which isn't scientific at all. The allure of religion lies in thinking that it will provide a gateway to do the transaction with God. When we think about God, for many people, the image of magic, mystic power, and heavenly forefather figure comes in foremost in front of their mind. If we remove this attribute, the concept of God instantly loses its charm and seems kind of really worthless to worship such entity. We believe in the concept of God as not to feel hopeless, as for many of us, the concept of absolute nihilism is totally dreadful and unbearable. The concept of God really helps us to look forward in something. Whether the God exists or not, everything is just being baked in our own head itself. So the concept of God, the concept of what we think, is just being developed over in our brain itself. And believing in a God is just like having a mental placebo itself. A lot of people nowadays are really looking towards the psychology, various scientific journals and articles to really just get an answer for all of the questions and doubt that they have been storing from a really long period of time. Let's say, why am I really happy? Why am I so sad? Why am I feeling so depressed? Or why am I really angry for my own boss itself? Or why am I really madly in love with a particular girl itself? Now, this is something which really science really tries to answer to an appropriate extent. It can really say that, hey, if you're really depressed, maybe your serotonin level is not really good enough. For that, you can really use some various supplements. You can really just kind of go and try to some change your diet. You can really modify. You can really just kind of do some exercises to really just be more relaxed, be more fresh, and be more energized itself. This isn't the case with the religion and God, to be precise. That it really kind of really depends on my belief system, and it really gives me a placebo that, hey, am I all good? Am I totally stud itself? Now, for some people, this may really work. For some people, it will not really work that much. Right now, we are done with the God. So let's now try to really answer one ultimate question, that why? Why on the earth do we really fight for abstract and unscientific idea like, let's say, religion itself? For that, you need to really understand one key main concept of human nature itself. Now, unlike other animals where they just fight for territorial acquisition, let's say a dog may just bark continuously at the night to protect its own territory. The problem with human is that we have got one more thing that completely differentiates us from the rest of the animal kingdom itself, and that is our brain. The problem with us is that we don't only fight for the territorial acquisition, we really also fight for to protect our ideas, to protect our individual identity itself. Because our identity kind of gives us the meaning and the purpose to live and to struggle this so harshful life itself. Now, if I really come to you and let's say give a chapter on nihilism, you will totally feel worthless. And you will feel that, why should I really struggle so hard? At the end of 60, 70 years itself, I'm just going to die anyway. So what's the matter of doing all of the hard work, providing value to the society? Why? So the religion kind of really just provides the meaning somewhat over here. And the religion, the custom, the tradition, as I really just spoke previously over here, it provides an essential value. It provides an identity to yourself that, hey, this is what I am. For everyone, their identity is their really closest thing, because it really kind of gives them the sense of belonging. Since we humans are social animals, and humans, if you really scan the entire history, humans have done various crazy things to prove the sense of belonging to a particular community itself. Humans have gone to various kind of wars to prove that, hey, I'm the part of this society and the part of this group itself. And to really be in a kind of really a mass group itself, you need to have an identity. You need to have kind of a purpose to just do certain thing in the society itself. And here's where the problem really starts. Now, if I really say that, hey, Hindu is shit or Muslim is shit, or although I don't believe in that, I repeat it again. let's say I really just say that Hindu is shit or Muslim is shit. Now, I'm not targeting to a religion. I'm actually targeting to your own identity. I'm targeting to your own actually instinct that you have been really believed for your entire childhood and entire adulthood itself. So this is kind of like a convoluted thing. Since in a transactional world, we need kind of some parameter to really just assess and credibility for an individual person itself. And for that, the identity, we need some kind of identity or parameters to really judge a person. And that can be name, the place, the culture, the ethnicity, the religion, because religion kind of has a really like a special area for our upbringing and the shaping our intellect itself. Since majority of the people have tied their identity to religion, it becomes as important material to really do the transaction with the world as currencies, let's say currency like rupees, dollar, yen, euros, and etc. Now imagine a dystopian world where I'm a Hindu Brahmin one day, and let's say I really chose to be a Maulanvi, or let's say I really chose to be a Christian missionary. What would that world really look like, where I could really just constantly hop from one religion to another religion? What would that utter extreme flexibility would look like? And here's one thought for your brain itself. Religion is the most successful MLM in the entire history of humanity. Now, why is that? I'm not really explaining it into deep because that would be really offending to a lot of people. But I would really leave it to interpretation for all of you. And if you want, you can just comment down in the comment section below. CRISPR-Cas9 or the gene editing technology is just on the verge. Now, imagine we really make a godlike creature with it. What would the religious figure or religious authority would really just comment over it? Let's say if we really make a religious figure, let's say, which could really satisfy all of the criteria of God. It has demonic power. It could really control all of the things. What would the religious figure really look like? And since the distance between the reality and illusion is really closing off together, because science is progressing at such a rapid scale that into VR, you won't really be able to distinguish that what is reality and what is illusion itself. So this is kind of thing that religion would really struggle in the future to really explain things itself. And already we are really seeing that religion is not really coping up with the present day scientific advancement itself. The most prominent area where religion really shows its true color is the inter-religion marriage. Let's say if you are in really love with another person who is from different religion itself. Now, if you are really from extreme conservative background, especially in India, you really face a lot of challenges in convincing your parents and convincing your other family itself that, hey, this is the person that I really love and this is the person that I really want to be in relationship with. And that is really like a hell lot of challenge, and I don't want to comment anything more on that. You can just search for various articles over there. Religion isn't possible without seduction. Don't get me wrong. Whether it's Muhammad, whether it's Prince Siddharth, aka Gautam Buddha, whether it's Jesus or anyone else, all really worked their ass off in spreading the word of religion amongst masses. The most plausible reason that I can think about why they were so successful is that one must know how to really command the human nature itself, which really brings me an excerpt from Art of Seduction by Robert Greene itself. 10. Use the demonic power of words to sow confusion. It is hard to make people listen. They are consumed with their own thoughts and desires and have little time for yours. The trick to making them listen is to say what they want to hear, to fill their ears with whatever is pleasing to them. This is essence of seductive language. Influence people's emotion with loaded phrases. Flatter them, comfort their insecurities, envelop them in sweet words and promises. And not only they will listen to you, they will lose their will to resist you. Isn't really religion exactly about this, the whole concept? I will leave this exactly to you. Now, what are my final words over here? Now, I'm not extreme religious, nor I'm extreme atheist. I'm somewhere in between. For me, what I've really just perceived or what I've just understood is that the governor of the consciousness is ultimately the God itself. Whatever really works, how the world really works, how the universe really functions, what really governs the laws of physics is ultimately the God itself. And things are really just really far beyond our perceivable concept. And there is a lot more to discover. And I do really think that we should be really open to all of the ideas, whether it's from religion, whether it's from anything, because ultimately it would really help us to really just kind of answer to the unknown quest or unknown territory that we humans really want to just kind of go on to go and discover the things for ourselves. But ultimately, the purpose of being secular, I'm not going to reveal what my religion is, because that really doesn't make any sense, because since I really demonstrated that I didn't really chose my religion for myself, because and it was just totally worthless to demonstrate and to say, hey, I'm really just Christian, or I'm really Hindu, or really I'm Muslim. That is up to you. I'm really leaving that quest for up to you. But what I can really say that if you really provide me all of the options that, hey, this is Hindu, this is Muslim, this is Christianity, this is Jain, this is both, what I'm really going to choose? My answer is straightforward. I would choose nothing, because I would treat all the religion like condoms. Now, before you really bash me, just hear me out. Now, just like there are various flavors and textures of condom to maximize the pleasure, I would really treat all of the lessons from, let's say, from Vedas and Puranas, from, I would take one verse from them, I would take one verse from Quran, I would take one verse from the teachings of Buddha, I would take one verse from Bible itself. I would really try to mix and mash together itself and see how can I really use it for my own life itself. The moment I really feel that, hey, this is something I'm not really relating right now, this is not really useful, I would just throw that into a dustbin, just like condom itself, when we just really finish our pleasureful activity itself. And that is really what I really want to say about religion. The next video is about relationships as well. So make sure you check that out.